I've been kindly sent a 6-watt laser by a Polish company called OpLaser. It's quite an interesting looking object with several through holes at the base to help cool the module while removing fumes. It looks very futuristic and almost like it should belong on a spaceship. In addition to this, I've been sent a magnetic docking station, which means the laser module can be removed and stored for safekeeping. This is particularly useful if you plan to install this on a CNC router, as the dust produced can damage the optics of a laser. I've also received some nifty safety goggles, a hood attachment which fits around the collimator lens and channels fumes and smoke from the laser beam, and an additional collimator lens. So the one on the laser module is for finer work, while the spare one produces a coarser beam. I want to use this on the CNC router I've been working on, but I've also got the remnants of the X-Carve inner drawer, and its belt driven system might work better for a laser engraver. So before I start, please be aware lasers are not toys, blah blah blah. Please do your own research before playing around with something that can knock your eyeballs for six.
I'm going to try and get started with installing this laser engraver onto my CNC machine. Although I'm not entirely sure how I'm going to do this. I did receive some diagrams with the parts, and I think there might be a little bit more on their website. But essentially what I'm going to do now is fit this section here, which is the quick release plate. So the idea behind this is, if you're going to store this onto a machine that also has a router, sawdust created from the router can actually affect the laser, can build up on the optics and degrade the cut essentially in the engraving.
The first thing I'm going to do is wire the laser to the magnetic docking station. I'll undo the wiring from the barrier block and replace them onto the green terminal connector. You really need to pay attention while doing this so you don't accidentally cross wires and fry your components.
Okay, be careful not to over tighten these. So that goes in like that.
These are really well made, well machined pieces. They have a strong positive hold and the instructions are pretty clear.
So I'm sort of in the process of recutting out my plates in aluminium.
Ideally, I should try think ahead and plan how to mount the laser so I can avoid further headaches. But that's a separate video, and before I do this, I'm going to check the wiring within my controller. When I made the controller, I wired the 4 PWM and spindle enable pins from the controller to a 4 PDT on-off on toggle switch. One half went to the VFD and spindle, and the other went to an RX16 panel socket mount.
What I should have done with this was actually wire only the PWM and the ground, and then also...
I wanted to have the options of adding a laser, but I didn't really know what I was doing or how I would wire this. This particular laser has a controller built in, and it can accept analog and TTL inputs. Both can be used as PWM, pulse width modulation. I don't need the spindle enable pins to reach the laser module, so I unsoldered those and wired up the power to the laser. You can use 12 to 24 volts, but you need to ensure the power supply unit can provide the minimal current, which is either 2.5 amps for the 12 volt or 1.5 amps for 24 volts. I'm going to wire the 24 volts.
Just turn it on.
In the end, I tried a few different wiring techniques, including wiring the power directly to the GX16 socket. This resulted in a fan constantly running.
You guys can look at the laser. Block.
In the end, I decided to separate the power and signal to the laser via two switches. That way I had two physical actions to complete, not including putting the laser module onto the docking stations before I started a laser job. If I forget to do any one of those things, the laser will not turn on. How you control the laser is determined by the software you're using and the firmware you have installed on your controller. I'm using Gerbil 1.1, which now has a laser mode written into it, which acts like a safety feature. $31 equals 1 activates laser mode, $32 equals 2 turns it off. These can be written into the G code before running a jog.
So what I've got now is a switch which sends the 24 volts to the laser, plus a switch which sends the signal either to the laser or to the VFD and then the spindle. So if I switch over to the laser, it won't turn on until I push the power down as well. And then if I swap over to the router, this will automatically turn off. Anyway, I'm going to try and draw this up now so I've got a record of what I've done.
The next thing I did was check the laser along a toolpath. I used a demo beta version of a G-code generator by Op Laser, which at the time of filming is not available yet. But I think it's going to be a contender. It looks very intuitive to use. I'm checking to make sure that when the laser mode is enabled, the laser turns off when the machine comes to a standstill. Otherwise I'd burn a hole in the wasteboard. I can't stress the safety aspect of working with lasers enough. You really need to be wearing the correct safety goggles, which block the wavelength range from the laser. You need good extraction, because lasering anything stinks and you can produce dangerous, toxic and volatile organic chemicals. You need to understand how air pressure works so that when you're extracting fumes from your working area, you are replacing the air in the room from a fresh and clean source. You will probably need a carbon air scrubber as well. I'm considering to make an enclosure for this machine, or at least make an additional hood that can fit around the laser beam using the appropriately tinted acrylic. There's probably more things you need to consider as well, which I haven't even fathomed. I turn this on and wear my goggles and hide behind my thick enclosure.
And I think the thing I have to remember is to make sure I check that the laser mode has been disabled, so it's $32 equals zero to do that. It's in the code to switch to it and then switch back, but if something goes wrong and I don't finish, then potentially the machine will be left on that setting. And if I switch to the router and try to cut something and the spindle stops spinning when it slows down, well, I'll look like an idiot, won't I?
I'm now 3D printing a part to mount the laser to the CNC machine. I made a quick model in Fusion 360, but I'm not going to show you how I did that, otherwise this video would last another 10 minutes longer, and that's too much viewing pleasure for you guys.
Okay, the holes look like they line up.
If you're interested in that, I have a similar video making a replacement bracket for a dial gauge on my main channel, which I'll link to in the information card. Anyway, I printed this out and test the design, only to realise I made a few mistakes. The recess holes for the nuts were too tight, and overall the laser was too high above the wasteboard.
Just put the wire through the drag chain and that fits like that. The only problem is it's really high up.
To get the full power of the beam, you should mount the laser module about 20 or 30 mils above the material you are working on. I kept the holes in the same position as I had already tapped the spindle acetal plates and fitted everything securely. I also added some boot ferrules to the wiring, which I had previously secured directly to the flex itself. I then did some test engravings.
Okay, I've got the fan over there. It's not long enough to reach here, although what I could do.
To focus the laser, I would run a toolpath and then press the pause button, and also turn the laser off at the power selector switch, and then toggle the culminator lens and then continue cutting. I did this a few times until the laser beam was in focus. Alternatively, you could write your own G-code to move the laser in stages along the Z-axis while engraving, so you can compare the outcome. You would then pick the best engraving and work out the offset from the Z-axis home. So to conclude, this is a nicely made bit of kit and it seems to work quite well, especially with the latest version of Gerbil. The guys behind this seem quite knowledgeable, and I have to admit I really like the aesthetics. It's quite sci-fi, it looks like it belongs on a spaceship. If you're interested in knowing more about the module and docking station, I'll place any affiliate links to them in the description. Hopefully by the time you see this video, their software will be available, but if not, you could always use Laser Gerbil. That is a free alternative, and I'll also link to that as well. Anyway, as per usual, please let me know your thoughts on laser engraving, cheese, the weather, and the ever-growing cost of birch ply in the description below. And don't forget to sacrifice a thumb. Anyway, thanks again for watching, and you'll catch me in the next one.